Hi class, this is Professor Dave, and we are going to do confidence interval estimates of a mean. Basically, we're trying to estimate a population mean with a confidence interval. Most of our intervals that we construct will contain the true population mean, and some of them will miss, as indicated by the sound of that broken glass. So the big picture, we have a population that we want to know something about, say how much people earn in our area. So we take a sample and we get our summary statistics. And we have a sample mean of, say, 65,000. But to infer something about the population, we know that sample results vary. Well, how much do they vary? Well, we're going to have to use a confidence interval. So we might say 65,000 plus or minus 5,000, or from 60 to 70,000. I'm 95% confident that from 60 to 70,000 contains the true population mean for the amount that people earn in my area. Okay, so let's see some examples. But the big picture, right? The sample mean is a point estimate. We're trying to estimate the sample size or the sample or the average that people earn. We get 65,000. Well, that's the point estimate, but we know it's off due to sampling error. Sampling error is just the natural difference from the true population mean and the sample result. And most likely the sample's result is off, so that's sampling error because you don't have it exactly. There's nothing wrong with the sampling process, it's just because it's off. So your point estimate's gonna be off, but it's probably gonna be close, but how much? So that's why we do a point estimate plus or minus a margin of error. And that margin of error takes into account the standard deviation and sample size. But we just take an X bar plus or minus E. And that is also because we have a symmetric curve, because that we'll see shortly, that sample means form a normal distribution. That's what this central limit theorem says. Okay, now reporting this, it actually gives visibility to the quality of the estimate, how much it could vary. Also gives us an exact statement. We're going to get a statement like 95%. We're 95% confident that our constructed interval contains the true population mean. So that's a very exact probabilistic statement, which is nice. Okay, so we just take X bar plus minus E, so it's X bar minus E and X bar plus E, and E is just equal to T times S divided by square root of N. Now the T here, think of it like a Z-score. It's just a little bit more spread out from a z-score because we don't know the population standard deviation. If we don't know the mean, we're not going to know the population standard deviation. So, and this s divided by square root of n is actually the standard deviation for sample means, that we'll see in the central limit theorem, times z, the number of standard deviations away from the mean, gives a distance away from the mean. In my other video I explain exactly why this works, why we are able to be 95% confident that our constructed interval contains a true population mean. So check that one out. Okay, so the central limit theorem basically says, given any population with any distribution, you know, so given a population with any distribution with a mean of mu and a standard deviation of sigma, every population has a mean and a standard deviation, and we take random samples of size n. So really, the given is just, we have a population, we're taking samples of size n, and we're defining the mean and the standard deviation. Okay, then one, the distribution of sample means becomes normal as the sample size becomes large. The mean of the sample means is equal to the population mean, so mu sub x bar is equal to mu, the population mean. And the standard deviation of sample means decreases. The standard deviation of x bar is equal to sigma divided by square root of n, which is what we just saw. So that's the standard deviation of sample means. Okay, now, the student T distribution was developed by William Gossett in the 1900s. And he worked at Guinness Brewing Company, and they had big batches of beer, and they didn't want to waste all of it, so they had pretty small samples. And so the degrees of freedom, the distribution, the T distribution, resembles the normal distribution, but it's a little bit more spread out. Okay, and we have the idea of degrees of freedom, which is n minus 1, and we'll get used to that. So here's a couple of student T distributions. Well, the standard normal is in black. We can see it here. And then with the student t distribution with sample sizes 3 or degrees of freedom is 2, we get the green one, and it's pretty spread out. With a student t distribution with n is equal to 11 or degrees of freedom is, or n is equal to 12 or degrees of freedom is 11, then we get the blue one, a little bit less spread out, but still more spread out than the normal curve. But they look pretty normal, and eventually it will go right into the normal curve. Okay, so the table that we use has this little area to the right here. This is just a subscript for the t value, but we have this little area to the right, alpha over 2. We want 95% confidence. Then we have 5% on the two outside sides combined, and half of 5% is 2.5%, so alpha over 2. Okay, and then we use the we find t values, which are basically z scores. But a little bit larger than the z-scores. We have the degrees of freedom, and then we have this little area to the right here, and that's what the little subscripts are here, and we'll see that in use. Okay, so let's do an example. Say for example we want to find the average credit card debt that students have, and we randomly ask sample 100 students, and we obtain a sample mean of 2300 and a sample standard deviation of 670. Estimate with 95% confidence interval the average debt that students have on their credit cards. Okay, so it's just x bar plus or minus e. E is equal to t times s divided by square root of n, and our confidence level is 95%. X bar is 2315, s is 670, n is 100. Degrees of freedom, therefore, is 99. And we look up on our table, and we get a t-score of 1.984. How do we get that? Let's go back to the t-table. Our degrees of freedom is 99. Okay, degrees of freedom is 99. It's not on there, so we'll use 100. And then we want a 95% confidence interval, so we have 2.5 on one side, 2.5 on the other, 95% in the middle. So we use this table, this one right here, t sub L, sub a, which is 0.025. So we use this one for 100 degrees of freedom, we get 1.984. Okay, so 1.984, that's what we use for t, so we plug in everything, and we calculate it, we get 132.928. What should we round this to? Well, our data was given to us in to the ones digit, so we'll round that to the ones digit. So very simply, it's just x bar plus or minus e. So we go 2315 minus 133, or 2182, and 2315 plus 133, or 2448. So our confidence interval is, for the amount of debt that people have, is we're 95% confident that the true population average of the amount of debt that students have is between 2181 and 2448. So there we have it. The interpretation of the confidence interval, we are 95% confident that our calculated confidence interval actually contains a true population mean. And what that means is 95 times out of 100, our confidence interval will contain the true population mean, and 5 out of 100 it won't, on average. And here's a picture of that. An Excel generated 100 samples, and we made these confidence interval samples with a mean of 50. And so here's our mean of 50. All the green ones contain 50, and the red ones miss. Now, is that really 100? It doesn't look like 100, but if you count them, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, and that's about 10, so 20, 30, 40, yeah, it's about 100. And on average, 95 will get it, and 5 will miss. So that's kind of what we, the interpretation of it. Okay, my other video shows why that is, so check that out. Let's do another example. Okay, now companies would be, in rural Africa, USA, would be keenly interested in how long their customers spend in the park. So they can do a simple random sample and ask them as they leave the park what time they arrived, and they can find out how long. Well, they sampled 144 customers, And the sample average was 311 minutes with a standard deviation of 72 minutes. Let's obtain a 90% confidence interval for the, just to do a different one, for the estimate of the mean time spent in the park and interpret the interval. Okay, so same thing, x bar plus minus e is equal to t times s divided by square root of n, and our confidence level is 90%. So x bar is 311, s is 72, n is 144, degrees of freedom is 143. So our t-score is right here. Let's see that. Okay, let's look at a t-table. All right, here's our t-table. And our degrees of freedom was 144. It's not on there, so we'll just use the closest one. And then we want a 90% confidence interval, so there's going to be 5% on the right side and 5% on the left side. So we look at 0.05 here. And so we do 140 and 0.05, and right here we get 1.656. So that's what we use. Okay, so let's go back to the slide. So we use 1.656. We plug everything in. So that t times our standard deviation divided by square root of n gives us 9.936. We always have to round that to the appropriate level. Our numbers are in the minutes, so let's round that to 10 minutes. So it's just x bar plus minus e, 311 plus minus 10, so we get 301 to 321. So we are 90% confident that this interval contains a true population mean, or we're 90% confident that the true population mean is somewhere between 301 and 321. There we go. Let's do one last example, and I'll show you how to do it on the calculator as well. Well, this one will look on the calculator. Suppose that we want to know how much time students study for a class. We randomly ask 20 students and ask them, you know, how long they study for a particular class. And we obtain this data. So estimate with 95% confidence the average time students study for a class. So what do we need to do? Well, we need to find the mean, the standard deviation, and the t-score. How many pieces of data? 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8. So our degrees of freedom is 7. And so we plug that in our calculator, and we calculate the mean and standard deviation. And the mean was this, and I'll show that all to you, and the standard deviation was this. Now, I'm leaving the standard deviation long because we'll just round after the calculation so we don't do the errors. N is 8, so degrees of freedom is 7, so we get a T of 2.365. Let's have a look at that one more time. So we want a 95% confidence interval, so we have 2.5 on both sides, or 2.5 over here. So we look at the 0.025 level here. Our n is 8, so our degrees of freedom is 7. So we get 2.365. So that's what we use. 2.365, we plug that into t, we have s divided by 8, we have this. So let's round it. What was our data to? Well, we had ones digits, you know, 7, 8, 6, and then we had a 6.5. So we'll round it to the tenths position. So our average was, we'll round that to the tenths position. One more level more accurate than the data is fine. So 7.4 plus minus 0.6. So 7.4 plus minus 0.9. So 7.4 minus 0.9 will give us 6.5, and 7.4 plus 0.9 gives us 8.3. So we're 95% confident that the true mean that students study for a class is somewhere between 6.5 hours and 8.3 hours. There we go. Now let's see how to do it on the calculator. Okay, so we'll turn our calculator on. Okay, and we go into stats and edit. And we can put the data in L1. I've already done that. And you can see all the data is in there. It's correct. So then we go into stats, and we can go calculate one variable statistics. It assumes L1, so we calculate it. We get x bar is equal to this, and s is equal to this. Okay, then we can do all these calculations. There's another way of doing it. We can go into stats, and we go to tests. So we'll scroll over to tests. And if you scroll down, you get number 8, the t interval. Okay, you hit enter. And you can plug in stats. Well, first you can go data, and it lists L1 confidence level. Let's say it's a 0.95, and yeah, the list is in L1. You can change that, but we put our data in L1. Frequency is 1 each, and if we go calculate, it calculates it for us real nice. So we get 6 point, that will round up to 6.5, and this will round to 8.3. And it gives us our mean and standard deviation in as well. So that's a time saver. Now say we just have the summary statistics. We can go stats, tests, down to T interval. There it is in number 8. And if we go into stats, enter, then we can put the mean here, the standard deviation here, and we do in the level. And we do that, we go down, hit calculate, and it'll give us the same thing. And there it is. Now let's do it for a problem back here. Let's do it for this one. So I'll put the data right here for the time spent at the amusement park. And let's see the calculator. So we go into stats, tests, T interval, enter. And now we can put in our statistics here. And our mean was 311. And our confidence level was 90%. We'll get to that. But our standard deviation was, there it is, 72. Our sample size was 144. Oops, missed the one. 144. It's good to check that, yeah. Confidence level is 0.9. Okay, 0.9. There we go. Now if we hit calculate, calculates everything. And this will round to 301 and rounds to 321. And that's how we get this interval as well in the calculator. But it is important to know what the calculator is doing. So going through those calculations and understanding why what it's doing is very important so that if you get into another situation that isn't a textbook situation, you can decide whether things are right or wrong. So check out my other video to see why we can be 95% confident, or why that works, and then you'll have the power of that as well. Well, I hope that was helpful, and enjoy your learning.